The Lord be with you. Welcome to Calvin Church this morning. The Almighty God has gathered us here and called us to worship Him, and it is very good that we are here together this morning. If you're visiting us or this is one of your first times here, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. We gather in the fellowship hall right over there after the service for coffee, juice, cookies, and hopefully you grabbed an order of worship on your way in. We follow that quite closely as we move through our worship. I have a few updates on our congregational life. Our sisters in Christ, Jean Reiskamp and Bernie Ritzma, both were receiving hospice care earlier this week, and we, along with their families, mourn their death but celebrate their life. Jean died on Thursday and Bernie on Friday. Two wonderful, wonderful women who lived full and very good lives. Jean's funeral service is Saturday, April 13 at 2 p.m. at Zagman Memorial Chapel. Bernie's funeral service is Monday, April 15 at 1 p.m. at Zagman's as well. Look for a prayer line email to remind you of all those things. And then another prayer matter is that Jack Van Zytveld had a mini stroke on March 28, but he's grateful to God because there are no lingering or residual effects from that mini stroke. So we can be thankful to God for that. And then we have two more Wednesdays where we will meet at 7 p.m. in the lounge during Lent to pray together. These have been prayer moments that have been full of the Holy Spirit, and we'll have two more of those prayer sessions, Wednesday, April 10, and then the 17th at 7 p.m. Now, let's prepare our hearts, our minds, our bodies for worship as the choir calls us to worship this morning.
You give me strength.
Friends, God has gathered us, and now God greets us. Grace and peace to you from God our Father, from Jesus Christ, his Son, and from the Holy Spirit, that same Spirit that makes us one, one with God and one as the people of God. Amen. The prophet Isaiah gives us these words from God in Isaiah 44, verse 22. I have swept away your transgressions like a cloud and your sins like mist. Return to me, for I have redeemed you. As we confess our sin to God this morning, we do it in the assurance that God sweeps away our sin in compassion. It's in that promise that we pray together, that we confess together. Let's do that using the prayer printed in our order of worship. Let's pray. God of birth, God of joy, God of life, we come to you as a people hungry for good news. We have been so dead to miracles that we have missed the world's rebirth. We have preoccupied ourselves with pleasures and have overlooked the joy you offer us. We have been so concerned with making a living that we have missed the life you set among us. Forgive us, gracious God. Open our eyes and our hearts to receive your grace. Open our lips and hands to share it with all humanity. In the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, God has once and for all swept away our sins like mist. In Jesus, we are forgiven. In Jesus, we are free. Amen.
Listening to his critics, strong yet gentle one, angry voices asking him how he could be God's son, charging him with blasphemy, making death his destiny. See him praying in the garden, truth and life and way, his friends sleeping, unaware that one would soon betray. Judas giving out advice, Christ the willing sacrifice.
In the assurance of our pardon, would you please stand if you're able, and we'll say together the Apostles' Creed to affirm our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I have this jar, and it has some stones in it and some rocks in it. And the bigger rocks on the top have things written on them, okay? So I'm going to take them out, and I'll read what it says on it, and then I'll hand it to you, and you can pass it around and look at them, okay? This one says, Herod's Marble, Israel 2008. Okay, you can take that. This stone just says Matthew 11, verse 2 through 6. This stone says nothing on it, but that's because it's too dark, so we couldn't write anything on it. But I remember that it's from Iceland. Okay, so you can pass that one around. Let's see. This one says Cuttyhunk Island, New England Saints, January 2012. This one says, walk with Brad. That's it. I think this was from a walk in college where I kicked this stone repeatedly the whole entire walk with Gwen, and then we kept it. But there you go. This one says, Caesarea Philippi, but no date. But that's from Israel too. This one says, walk to Walden 2007, simplify. And I think this one's from there too. Yeah, this one says worry stone in quotations, so I think you hold it when you're feeling worried. This is from the same thing, walk to Walden 2007. There you go. And maybe one more. Nope, this one doesn't have anything on it. So Gwen and I take these stones from places that we've been either together or separately. Here, you want to put them back in? You got them all, huh? Places that we've been either together or separately that mean a lot to us. And we take these stones and we write something on them in order to remember where we got the stone and then to remember the story of maybe what God did in that place for us, what God did in that place in the past. And it's kind of a fun thing that we do together because otherwise we might not remember these things, the ways that God has shown up in our lives in the past. If we didn't have these stones to kind of go through and hold in our hands and show each other, maybe these memories would have slipped our mind. But because we have these rocks, it helps us to remember and then to share the stories with each other when we read these stones. Remembering what God has done in the past is something that is very important to the life of faith in the Old Testament and in the New Testament and for us now. Remembering what God has done, the stories from the Bible, and remembering what God has done in our lives as well. But that's not the only aspect to faith in God. Remembering is important, but that's not the only part of faith. But I'm not going to tell you the other part because we're going to talk about it in the sermon this morning, okay? And maybe we can have a conversation later about that too. So, as you go, though, throughout your week or your lives, maybe if something really great happens or an important moment in your life of faith, maybe grab something like a stone, something that you can hold on to and write on so you can hold that memory literally in your hand and in your heart, and you could remember how God has been present and faithful to you in the past. Can you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for showing up for us time and time again. You are our almighty God, and we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, friends, let's stand to receive a blessing from the congregation. People of God, what is your prayer for these children? And also with you.
Grow in peace, love, and serve the Lord. Thank you, Ken. Musicians, choir, thank you. Our congregational prayer today will be divided into two sections, just as the order of worship informs you. The first is a prayer of thanksgiving, and the second a prayer of intercession. They will be one continuous prayer. And so I invite you, recognizing that each of these prayers could be interminable, but in the interest of keeping space for the rest of the service, I will be determined not to make it so. But I invite you to link your hearts and your minds, and if you like, your hands with the person next to you as we pray. Gracious God and loving Father, we come to you because there's no one else to whom we can give such adoration and such thanks. We are delighted in this season of the year, Father God, that your world reminds us that new life is coming, that spring is on the way, and as our eyes take in the blooms, we are thankful for eyes to see. As the birds remind us of their migration, we are grateful for ears to hear. And in this time of delight, we remember especially those of our number and of other numbers who are traveling. And we thank you for recreational opportunities. We thank you for games. We thank you for families. We thank you for friends with whom we can celebrate. We thank you for beaches and trees and toys and cars and highway systems, all of the things that delight us. These are your gifts, and we thank you for access to them. This day, Father God, as we listen to the rhythm and the sounds of your world, we thank you for the gift of music, for writers and poets, for composers and arrangers, for talented conductors, singers, musicians, and for ears to hear the sounds and for minds to absorb what it means to praise you, what it means to be troubled at times when we see trouble, and what it means that we live in hope, as music reminds us. We thank you this day, Father God, that most of our world is at peace. We thank you that most people, most of the time, are not violent. We thank you that as image bearers, we can extend your love, and we would do that wherever we go. We thank you that so many of us are healthy, and we thank you for the gift of access to medical resources, to food and drink that is not only nutritious, but delightful and enjoyable. We thank you for facilities in which to prepare these things, and for places in which to share communion beyond simply the food. We thank you, Father God, for the evidence of progress that we see in this your world. We thank you that this day, fewer around the world will live in grinding poverty. We thank you that this day, more have access to educational resources, and that more can read and learn your good word, but also can discover the delights of intellectual knowledge and advancement. For all of these gifts, and so very many more, Father God, we give you thanks. Hear our thanks and perfect our praise through Jesus Christ. We remember, Lord God, that while there is much to be grateful for, the world is not as you created it, and we mourn. We mourn even as we celebrate the lives of our sisters, Jean and Bernie. We thank you for the lives that they've given, but we join families and friends in recognizing that there now is an empty spot that they once filled. We thank you, Father God, for the good news of recovery for Betty Frieswijk, for Jacqueline Seidfeld, for Art Youngsma, and for others. But we mourn that there is brokenness in your world, that our bodies are not always our friends, and that there are times that we wish that we were feeling ever so much better. Bear us through those times, Father God, and help us to be a ministry of love as our colleagues, family, and loved ones experience changes. We mourn that dementia enters your world and colors our abilities to think, and we ask that when our turn comes, we be treated kindly, and that we, as your body, will do just so. We recognize, Father God, that in spite of recreation, things are broken, and we ask that you help us through those times of brokenness. We recognize, too, that even though there is harmony in your world, there is chaos that sometimes sounds above the harmony. Tune our ears to listen for you, we ask. Make us strong, not too caught up in the hubbub and chaos of everyday living, but help us always to listen to the sounds that confirm that you are in control, that you remain Lord and God. While it is true, Father God, that there is peace throughout much of your world, too many still are warring. Too many lives are taken, needlessly, for causes that will not stand. And so we mourn the presence of war. We mourn violence, and we ask, Father God, that you enable us as your servants to be agents of healing. Help us to know how to pray for those who have too long known lives of violence. We recognize that while health care is a good thing and that many of us are healthier, we also note that some lack access. We note that the playing field for this resource and many others is not level. And so we ask for your wisdom to guide us to know what is right and how we might work toward justice and toward improving access. Help us, Father God, to do this in your name. While we celebrate that many more can read, we also recognize that some are barred from access. It troubles us to note that there are people held back from school, from learning, by the demands of everyday life, by the lack of resources, by the absence of support, and we ask that you help us to know how to seek justice in this regard as well. We recognize, Father God, that while many this day live better than ever, we also recognize that poverty continues. And despite the fact that many now have more, some still have too little and will not survive this day. We ask there, Father God, that you help us and help your people who call on your name to work again toward justice. All these things we pray, Father God, with great thanks and with great petition. We pray knowing that Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, prays continually for us, and we ask that you listen to him and to the groanings of your Spirit, perfecting this prayer and every prayer that is offered in your name, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Our scripture reading this morning is Isaiah 43, verses 16 through 21. This can be found on page 586 of your pew Bibles. Before we read, let us go to our God in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for giving us your word this morning. Please help us to understand it and apply it to our lives through the message from your servant Brad. Amen. Isaiah 43. This is what the Lord says, He who made a way through the sea, a path through the mighty waters, who drew out the chariots and horses, the army and reinforcements together, and they lay there, never to rise again, extinguished, snuffed out like a wick. Forget the former things, do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up, do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the desert and streams in the wasteland. The wild animals honor me, the jackals and the owls, because I provide water in the desert and streams in the wasteland to give drink to my people, my chosen, the people I formed for myself, that they may proclaim my praise. This is the word of the Lord.
A Homecoming by Wendell Berry. One faith is bondage, two are free. In the trust of old love, cultivation shows a dark, graceful wilderness at its heart. Wild in that wilderness, we roam the distances of our faith, safe beyond the bounds of what we know. O love, open. Show me my country, take me home. In the book of Deuteronomy, God, often through Moses, commands the people of Israel to remember 14 times. Here are just a few examples. Deuteronomy 24, verse 18. Remember that you were a slave in Egypt, and the Lord God redeemed you from there. Therefore, I command you to do this. Or Deuteronomy 32, verse 7. Remember the days of old. Consider the years long past. Ask your father, and he will inform you, your elders, and they will tell you. As the people of God prepared to enter into the promised land, over and over again, God instructs them in Deuteronomy to remember. It's as if God is saying to them, remember what I've done for you, the miracles that I've worked, the ways I have been repeatedly faithful to you and to your ancestors. After all, the people of Israel and us can be very forgetful people. Oftentimes, the people of Israel were so caught up in the experience of a moment that they forgot what God had done for them. When they were in the wilderness and complaining and saying, we want to go back to Egypt, they weren't remembering how God had delivered them from the bondage that they experienced so miserably in Egypt. A few years ago, in a coffee shop in Holland, my friend David told me how the goodness of God in his life to that point was vital to the way he lived out his faith now. He remembered God acting time and time again in his life, even as he grew up in a family that was broken by tragedy, by confusion, by distrust. And just the fact that he was now in his 30s and in seminary was evidence enough to him of God's faithfulness in his life. He said to me, whenever I'm plagued by doubts or feelings that I don't belong here, I look back and remember all the ways God has showed up for me, and I'm reassured. Remembering, both for the people of Israel, for David, for us, remembering plays a crucial role in the life of faith. And we could even say that our worship is a mode of remembering. Remembering the things of God and praising God for what God has done in the past. And I don't doubt that as you have grown in your faith, there are significant past moments you return to. Moments where God comforted you or sent you real peace or showered you with love. And we do this collectively when we celebrate communion. We remember Christ's sacrifice on the cross. Do this in remembrance of me, Jesus says. And that resonates, that command to remember resonates with the majority of Scripture, with the church's tradition and worship, and with our own personal experiences of God. So that makes Isaiah 43:18 quite a shock to our system. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. Do not remember the former things. Do not remember? How is that possible? Even the verses right before verse 18 appear to encourage remembering what God has done in the past. Verses 16 and 17 contain multiple allusions to God's miracle working at the Red Sea. God made a way in the sea. God made a path in the mighty waters. And yet, God tells the people of Israel not to remember the things of old. You can just hear them. Well, what about Passover, where we remember God's deliverance in Egypt? Or what about the Festival of Tabernacles, where we remember God's provision while we were in the wilderness? Do not remember? The prophet most likely spoke these words to the people of Israel as they were exiled in Babylon, where, quite honestly, they had grown comfortable. At this point, they could make a life in Babylon, and they could even continue to worship God using the same methods and traditions that they had for hundreds of years, minus actually being in the temple. But again, they had grown accustomed to being here in Babylon. They can make it work. But God commands them not to remember the former things because he is about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? God's saying that God will do an even more miraculous thing than parting the Red Sea. He'll make a way in the wilderness. He'll bring water, rivers of water even, through the desert. He'll make these wild and erratic animals like jackals or ostriches or owls in the translation that Bobby read, these animals that represent chaos, he'll make even those animals honor him. God is about to do a new thing. And God tells them not to remember the former things because in doing so, they risk blinding themselves to the new thing God is about to do. New methods, new miracles, new life. And so here's the primary question, I think. Do we have a faith that doesn't expect anything new from God? We are not done learning about and experiencing God's activity, But sometimes we have a tendency to act as though we are done. We know how God works. Do we have a faith that doesn't expect anything new from God? Because God's presence and God's work in our lives is not limited to the past. I am about to do a new thing, says God, in your life, in my life, in the life that we share together. Do you not perceive it, asks God? Do we? Do we have eyes to see? In his commentary on this passage, Walter Brueggemann says that the Creator God will renovate and restore all of creation. That's what the latter half of these verses are moving toward. The Creator God will renovate and restore all of creation. So Isaiah 43, 16 through 21 then becomes a call for us, for the church, to be attentive to God renovating and restoring. And not only to be attentive to God renovating and restoring, but to expect it of God. Absolutely. You and I know that God has been faithful in the past. But we make a huge mistake if we assume that God can only act in the past. Or if we think that God will always act in the same way that he has acted in the past. God is consistent, but his ways, his methods can always be new. I'm reminded here of that famous scene in C.S. Lewis's The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Lucy and really the rest of the siblings are talking to Mr. and Mrs. Beaver, and they're talking to them about Aslan. Do you remember this? And Mr. and Mrs. Beaver tell her that Aslan is a lion who causes your knees to shake, or who would cause your knees to shake when you're in his presence. Then he isn't safe? Lucy asks. And Mr. Beaver responds, safe? Don't you hear what Mrs. Beaver tells you? Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe. But he's good. He's the king, I tell you. God is the king of the universe, and he is good. But his goodness isn't bottled up in the past. I am about to do a new thing, God says. And that new thing might feel to us that it's not safe. That new thing might shake us to the core. It might make us a little bit uncomfortable. That new thing might actually exhilarate us or give us new energy. But whatever the case, if God is bringing a new thing, it comes from God, who is active now and who is good. Many who have studied this passage have pointed out that Jesus was and is a newness from God that is far more earth-shattering than rivers in a wasteland. Jesus was God in the flesh. Jesus was Emmanuel, God with us. Jesus is a new thing. And there were those when Jesus first came to earth, and I suppose there are those now, but there were those when Jesus first came to earth who could not accept or perceive the new thing God was doing in Jesus. Stories in the Gospels are littered with these sorts of people. The Pharisees, the scribes, the Romans, and at times, the disciples. They couldn't accept the new thing God was doing in Jesus. But no doubt God was doing a new thing in Jesus. He was redeeming the entire world and conquering sin once and for all. So far be it from us to limit the God of Jesus Christ, the God who redeemed the world and conquered sin once and for all. Far be it from us to limit that God to just working in the past. Far be it from us to not expect that God, that Jesus, to still work in this world and to work in our hearts. As I was saying to the kids earlier, faith in God, it seems then, must be two-sided. Faith remembers what God has done in the past, yes. Obviously, you can't read scripture without noticing all the commands to remember what God has done and to tell about what God has done so everyone remembers together. So faith remembers what God has done in the past, but faith also expects for God to do a new thing. Walter Brueggemann puts it this way: faith requires a thick memory that is always letting ancient miracles be reenacted in fresh and daring ways. So where do you see God doing a new thing? Where do you see God active right now? Let me just name a few places where I've seen God active or doing a new thing in the last few weeks. I saw God active, doing a new thing, as Pastor Jake shared deep words of comfort and strength with Betty Frieswijk and her family before her surgery on Friday. I saw God active and doing a new thing in the meal coordinator at Campus Elementary. Every Thursday, I go down as a Kids Hope mentor, and I wait outside the lunchroom to take my student and mentor or have a time with him. And always the meal coordinator, she's standing right there, and we have like a 5-minute conversation. And she is a woman who devotes everything that she is, every fiber of who she is, to those kids. And she tells me almost every Thursday, I don't stop praying for these kids. I don't stop praying for them. I saw God active and doing a new thing in her. And I saw God active and doing a new thing in the laughter of my nephews, in new spring bursting forth, in the birds chirping and singing outside my office window. Where do you see God doing a new thing? Where do you see God active right now? Let's hear that Wendell Berry poem once more to close. And I'm not sure if you heard it the first time, but the poem speaks of two faiths. And I like to think of it as one faith with two components. Two components that are indispensable. A faith that remembers the past, what God has done, and a faith that expects God to do a new thing. Here it is again. One faith is bondage, two are free. In the trust of old love, cultivation shows a dark, graceful wilderness at its heart. Wild in that wilderness, we roam the distances of our faith, safe beyond the bounds of what we know. O love, open, show me my country, take me home. Friends, remember what God has done in the past. Expect God to do a new thing now in the present. Look for God this week. And in 2 weeks, as we celebrate Easter, the resurrection of our Lord, we will really experience and know that God does a new thing. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Let's pray. Holy and almighty God, send your Spirit on us so that we have eyes to see where you are doing a new thing. And we have hearts that remember and trust deep in our bones what you have done in the past. Show us, Lord, that you are a God who cannot be limited, but you are a God who is good. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm not Kornmeyer, I'm his fill-in. Today's offering is for the Micah Center. The Micah Center was founded in 2012 by several members from several area churches. They focus on social injustice issues in the community, including immigration, workers' rights, and wages. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the work the Micah Center is doing in our community. Thank you for people that care about those who sometimes get marginalized in society. Bless our offerings today. May it do good work. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Would you rise to receive a blessing from our God? Friends, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you as you go. Amen.